Afrika zenzoqalana kodwa sifuna izinkinga zenu nemifuzo yenu bayitholakale Congress.
Kazi funa umqatshazwe kurebo siphendula ngemali esifunayo kuphela sikwazi emsebenzini kodwa engakasiphendula imali esifunayo asizisuka apha singazisuswa ngabo la maphoyisa lapha.
Why the use of police force onto the teeth against miners who were not occupying mining property or territory, were not occupying any strategic point, were not blocking the national highway or any minor road?
I said, all this is in God's hands. I'm a mortal man, those are my words. I'm a mortal man. I still remember vividly the face of those workers.
Let us take note of the fact that whatever happened represents the best of responsible policing.
My name is Fahraaz Patel. Jazakallah, thank you so much for staying with us. That is a trailer from the Emmy award-winning documentary, Miners Shut Down. It premiered 10 years ago, 2 years after the devastating Marikana massacre. We are now 12 years on from that massacre, and yet more questions than answers continue to remain. The justice for the 34 miners. It just was not the 34 miners that suffered. It's the families. Until today, the community of that very same mining area still reels from poverty. But more importantly, they're still looking for answers as to what had happened on that day. Let me introduce my guests for tonight's discussion. I'd like to welcome the director of that very documentary, Rehad, Desai. And in studio, I'd like to welcome from the Socioeconomic Rights Institute, Nomzamo, Zondo. Nomzamo's institution currently represents the families of those 36 miners who, of course, had lost their lives. She's going to be talking about the accountability mechanisms. Is there still that accountability mechanism right now, 12 years on? But before I speak to Nomzamo, I'd like to welcome Rehad. Rehad, assalamu alaikum. Thank you so much for joining us here on Talking Point.
Thank you.
Rehad, so much had happened prior to August the 16th. It was a build-up of so many things, and of course, you were there, you had spoken to the communities, you had spoken to some of the miners that had actually survived. Talk to us about that, because there's an emotional aspect, but there's also an aspect of shooting a documentary that tells the true story leading up to August the 16th and beyond.
Yes, indeed. I mean, we had a situation where mine workers were taking strike action in the run-up to this Marikana strike, or in disputes, and they were doing this outside of the union, the National Union of Mine Workers, which was the dominant union at the time in the platinum sector. They were doing this because they knew platinum mines were making an awful lot of money on their sweat. And the one mine down the road, Amplats, was 6 months before, had a strike, and the union disavowed them during that strike. that didn't get behind them, and they then decided to join the rival union, the UMKU. And I think the powers to be in government and in the mining sector started to get very worried, because UMKU was representing itself as a more militant union and more willing to get behind the workers and the issues that they face at work, particularly the wage demands. So we had a situation where the management at Lonmin, which was the company at the time, now owned by Sibanye Steel Waters, refused to recognize these mine workers. And they were saying, well, we don't know who they are and things like that, quickly beginning to demonize them and criminalize them. And we saw, you know, the ruling party and the union, and indeed the South African Communist Party, describing these mine workers in all sorts of negative ways as tribalists, chauvinists, suicidal, and so on, in the run-up to the massacre. So it was a very tense moment. We had the involvement for the first time in my history with the labor, big labor disputes, traditional healers involved, because of this vacuum of leadership that represented itself. So private security were running amok. They were attempting to intimidate these mine workers back to work. And in the run-up to the fateful killings, we saw a number of lives lost. So in total, there were 44 lives lost when we include the security guards and the police. And I think these were also victims, as I'm sure Nomzamo will speak more about, of the greed of the mining houses at the time. So, yeah, it was a very traumatic film to be involved with, to see the footage come out from the commission, the police footage in particular, which showed how these machine guns had basically obliterated people's bodies, these automatic rifles. So, and it never needed to happen that way. We never should have seen our police force being used by a multinational corporation, a capitalist company, whether local or international, getting involved in a labor dispute, a bona fide labor dispute. That is something that needs to be sorted out between the management and the workers. And we know what this led to, because the police force were being willing to be led by the mining company. And indeed, many unanswered questions about the role of the police minister, the cabinet. These minutes have not been made available to us. The minutes of the commissioners, the national police, the top management of the police, those minutes went missing. The fact that we've seen no prosecution of the people who we saw shooting the mine workers in the trailer of the film there never came before the commission. And I think despite the commission's problems blaming the mine workers, there are many very solid recommendations which were never implemented. So, yeah.
Nomzamo, I want to come to you. Good evening. Thank you so much for joining us. Nomzamo, the history of South Africa, we talk of Sharpeville, we talk of June the 16th, we talk of the Bisho massacre, we talk of many moments in our history where this has happened, and we're thinking in 1994, post that, this should not happen. And here we are, it happens. And it was mine workers striking for one thing and one thing only, to live a better life. This shouldn't have happened, but it did.
And the challenge isn't even that it did, right? Is how the state responded after it did. It attempted to demonize the miners. To, in fact, the first response was to arrest those that survived for the murders of those that the police killed. How ridiculous is that to start? But the ultimate response in the last 12 years from the state hasn't been to acknowledge to say we're a democratic government. We have no business killing our own citizens, especially when they are in a bona fide dispute between them and their employer for a living wage. But unfortunately, we found the families that were represented, I think the miners themselves, have found themselves sitting across a state that fails to recognize how wrong it is to have murdered their family members or to have murdered their colleagues or to have put them at risk because the miners survived the massacre on the one hand, and then has, in effect, in the last 12 years, refused to compensate for the very pain caused by that massacre. And so we can speak today about the fact that we should not have had a post-apartheid massacre, but we did. But the response itself was as brutal as the response of the apartheid government to the massacres that happened at that time.
After the break, I continue my conversation with Rehad, Desai and Nomzamo Zondo. Justice, yes, there is a massive question mark with regards to that. The fact that there still isn't any at this moment, 12 years on. To stay tuned to Talking Point, we'll be back after this break. Welcome back to Talking Point. We are commemorating the Marikana massacre 12 years on and the question of justice, justice that continues to linger for so many families that suffered on that tragic day. Nomzamo, your institution, of course, represents the families of the 36 striking miners, and you've interacted with them. They've shared the experiences. You've dealt with it in the legal way, and of course, there has to be the separation between emotion and, of course, dealing with the law. Talk to us about that. Talk to us about how the frustration of these families, both from a professional perspective, but also from a human perspective.
Look, so I think very early on from the time that they participated in the Commission of Inquiry, one of their key complaints was the fact that those who shot and killed their loved ones didn't come to give evidence before the Commission of Inquiry. And so they looked forward to the criminal prosecutions of those responsible because they would give them an opportunity to hear firsthand what happened and why. And unfortunately, 12 years later, there has not been any prosecution for the murders that happened on the 16th of August 2012. At least there has been at least two sets of prosecutions, one in relation to the attempt to hide the circumstances around which one of the miners had died, and two, the killings that had happened 3 days before, where three mine workers died and two policemen were killed, and of course another policeman was injured. And for the families, just simply being able to sit in a courtroom where police are expected to account for their actions has given them a level of satisfaction. To see them cross-examined by the National Prosecuting Authority, to see the NPA stand on their side asking questions about why people like Mr. Soganyile were shot hundreds of meters away from their shooters, and that has given them some satisfaction. But the fact that there's been no prosecution for the 6th of August is a standing complaint. It also betrays the National Prosecuting Authority's commitment to render justice to the families. In the number of times we have raised the lack of prosecutions and the lack of even to take a decision around the prosecutions, the NPA's position to us is that they are still investigating. They've reformulated their legal team. Even as recently as last year, we were told that a new team is in charge of the prosecutions, and that team is still busy with investigations 12 years on. Of course, someone would then ask, is there any point to prosecuting 12 years on? Would the witnesses remember the details? Will they remember what happened? And of course, there will be difficulties. But the families, even yesterday, one of the widows was speaking to me on the phone, and she reminded me of a conversation we'd had with Jim Nichols, one of the attorneys who'd worked with us, who's a solicitor based in the UK. And he had said, you know, he knows of a community that waited 40 years for justice, and 40 years that they had gotten it. And she said to me, Nomzamo, even for us, we will stand and call for justice until it arrives. If it means 40 years, then we will do that. And with that, she's a widow. Her children were young when the incident happened. Some of them now are adults and are able to are already participating in questioning the slow pace of justice. But it also means that the community of people who are calling out for justice grows. I think the families have been strengthened by the support they've received from the general public. And at the very top of that is the Marikana support campaign that has continued to call for justice from the date of the massacre. It is also the community that they've built as the families of the deceased, and as Rehad explained earlier on, that even though the police killed 37 minors in that week, there are 44 lives that were lost. And our clients, whose loved ones were killed by the police, take the view that the other 7 lives were lost due to capitalist greed, were lost because a lawman prioritized their profits over the lives, even of the 9 striking mine workers. And they've formed a community and together have called for justice, not just for those whose loved ones were killed by the state, but also those who lost their lives in that week.
Rehad, there's a moment within the documentary, and I was able to watch it before we started this, you know, panel discussion, where one of the striking miners who had survived the attack said, quote unquote, I was going to die for money. Who would have thought that in a democratic South Africa, 18 years on from 1994, that the marginalized of our society, the very same people who were victims of colonialism and apartheid, would be saying that? I mean, that hit home, didn't it? When you were sitting there, of course, doing this documentary, listening to this very same citizen of our country and those words, dying for money. It shouldn't be happening, but that's what the reality was at the time and probably still is.
A good section of the South African population. These mine workers were at the center of the local resistance, the internal resistance to the system. They powered their branches, and their union structure was able to take the arguments and the campaign of the ANC for a democracy in the early 90s. Before our first elections, into the countryside. Now, for these, for the ruling party really to side or sanction the use of thousands of police and live ammunition and so on, and we're assuming they did, against a group of striking mine workers when they're also in an alliance with them, you know, KASATU, the National Union of Mine Workers, was sitting at the center of that alliance. It was shocking. It was shocking for me. I grew up in exile in inside the liberation movement, and I think many other people who were supportive and active inside the ruling party turned their backs on the ANC following that massacre. It was clearly something that was planned. It wasn't an accident. We saw what was happening in the run-up to that. So clearly a sense, many people felt it on the body. It was a sense of betrayal. So it was shocking that, and it showed us how deep into the pockets that our politicians, into the pockets of these big corporations, had fallen. It was utterly, we just couldn't believe it. You know, when I saw what had happened, it was, a line had been drawn in the sand, certainly for me, and I think many others. And we saw a year later, the EFF was formed on the basis of that massacre, a party which for many years was the third biggest party in the country. We saw the National Union of Metal Workers leave the big federation, KASATU, big trade union federation, because of this, weakening tremendously our trade union movement. We saw a huge amount of disaffection across society. And I think, you know, the campaign together with the lawyers, the good work that was done at the commission, we challenged the narrative that somehow these mine workers were to blame. We contested that narrative all the way and pointed the finger quite squarely at the state. And I think a number of important victories were won in that that fight for public opinion.
After the after the break, we are going to touch on, you know, just the accountability mechanisms and those who were on the side of workers really turning around, of course, in post-democratic South Africa. Nomzamo, before we go to the break, the tears, the agony, it's something that reminded us of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and that was found to hold perpetrators of apartheid accountable. And commissions frustrate people. Did you see frustration within the victims that you represented during the Falun Commission, and the fact that answers are still not coming?
I think it's important to place the commission in a balanced light. I think for our clients, there are many pieces of information that they would not have had if they did not participate in the commission. As Rehad points out, there was a strong narrative of multi-crazed miners who attacked the police. It is in the commission that we all learn that the police do not even have an individual with a scratch who was attacked by these multi-crazed miners. In fact, it was in the commission that the police narrative was that they attacked our Nyala. That was, and part of our case was to prove that the Nyala, the police vehicle, the police van, came with the injuries that it came with. And it would have been impossible to get that information without the commission. But also the most important and the most damning piece of information is around probably three things. One, the ammunition that was ordered before that morning. The ordering of mortuary vans to carry 32 bodies in the morning of the 16th of August. And then thirdly, the fact that we know which police officers discharged their firearms, how many times, and we have the police statements. Without that commission of inquiry, we wouldn't have that information. Wouldn't be able to stand and accurately and justifiably accuse the ANC-led government of massacring the workers without the commission of inquiry. Of course, there were costs. Our clients left their homes for 2 years in order to sit in that commission of inquiry. When the commission finished, when it submitted its report to President Zuma, President Zuma refused to release the report. And then weeks after he received it, he said he would release it to the public without paying any attention to the family members and the miners who were closely traumatized and traumatized by this event. But at the very same time, I think even as we sit now, we think, yes, the NPA has not made a decision around the prosecuting those responsible for the 16th of August. But we know that the evidentiary material is available to us so that when the day they decide not to prosecute, the families and those who support them can pursue a private prosecution. Another important thing is the role played by lawmen about the collusion between lawmen and the state, and also the fact that there were other political factors that played a role into the decision of whether or not the strike ends and how it ends. And a lot of that information would have been lost to all of us, would have been lost to all of South Africa, but also would have been especially lost to the families who, in the early days of August 2012, were being told, it's your son who's caused you to have this loss, to suffer this loss. If it's not him, it's his fellow miners who at that time were standing in the dock, charged with the murder of the 34 miners who were killed. But because we sat in that commission, we are able to look at everyone straight in the face and say, this massacre forces us to call for justice against a black-led post-democratic government. It forces us to call for justice against a mining company, which in effect probably retains the power and the relationship that it had with the previous government. And then at the very last, it allows us to create solidarity between the families and the rest of South Africa, because they are then able to say to them, whatever you heard in the past is not true. Here is the truth. In fact, the organization that I work for manages a website that provides the exhibits that were given in the commission. So any member of the public can go and look at the phone call between the General Mbombo, who was the Northwest Commissioner, and the Lomnin officials about what must happen with the miners. And all of that is only because we had the Commission of Inquiry.
After the break, state mining conglomerates, what is the link? What was the link on that very same day? We'll be touching on that after the break. Welcome back to Talking Point. The police minister at the time was Natim Tetwa. The Minister of Mineral Resources and Energy, as it was called then, for the fifth administration was Susan Shabangu. The president of the country at the time, Jacob Zuma. The deputy president, President Cyril Ramaphosa. But who was he at the time also? He was the non-executive director of the very same mine in Marikana, Lonmin. Rehad, in that interview with Cyril Ramaphosa, who of course now is serving in his second term as the president of the republic, there wasn't really much given from him. And if you go to the communities of Marikana, and 2 years ago on the show we had somebody from there, there's a harboring of anger, there's a harboring of hate, and there's a harboring of pity of what had happened, especially to the number one citizen of this country. President Cyril Ramaphosa still has that question mark over him, even though that very same Falun Commission had cleared him. That interview, talk to us about that, because there was something missing from there, wasn't it?
Yes, I think he was scared that he may be prosecuted, and therefore he was acting under legal advice not to talk about the unfolding events and his own participation, communication, and so on with the other Lonmin directors. He was a Lonmin director at the time. He had the equivalent of $370 million, I believe, investment inside the company. It may be bigger. Nomzamo, please correct me if I'm wrong. What I wanted to know is, given the man's credibility amongst the mine workers at that time, before this massacre, that he would be listened to and he would be given an audience by many of those striking miners, many of them still NUM members at the time, a union which he established, founded. Why didn't he go there and talk to them? about their dispute and what they were asking for, and to get them around the table so a negotiation could begin. Rather, he refused that question, and the police quickly took over on the day before, the afternoon of the day before, and chased mediators from the church away, such as Reverend Sioka, from the scene, told UMCU leaders and so on not to. So it was a very difficult interview. I mean, he at one stage he said, "Listen, you didn't tell me you were going to be asking all these questions. This interview has to end." So I had to retreat. So it was tame. But, you know, as I said in the documentary, people like Cyril Ramaphosa, as a socialist, you know, I'm an avowed socialist. He was a hero to me in the 80s and early 90s. I thought that we could rely on people like him to lead us to the South Africa that we really needed, a South Africa which was just, where equality would be deeply undermined, where we would build the foundations for a new society. But what we've seen over the years is basically a replacement of the white economic elite with a small portion of the black economic elite. And he's been one of the major beneficiaries of that black economic empowerment program, which has not trickled down in any shape or manner to the people that they argued at the time it would be. But quite frankly, this notion touted at the time that we would be able to build a patriotic black bourgeoisie is simply nonsense, and history has been the test of that assertion or assumption.
Nomzamo, there's something poignant what Rehad is mentioning, because Cyril Ramaphosa and the entire cabinet of that very same, and it's actually the fourth administration, I was corrected there, that you've got figures like Nadim Tetwa, Susan Shabangu, Jacob Zuma, Riab Piech. They know what apartheid is. They know what the struggle of the black, blue-collar worker is. They understand it because they've been there. How could it be that at a day like August the 16th, and even prior to that, and even post that, given that these communities still suffer, there seems to be still a lack of touching distance in understanding what the poor class of South Africa is going through?
I mean, that's a difficult thing. I think when Rehad speaks about the fact that President Ramaphosa is one of the founders of NOM, it means that the workers would have expected that he would be on their side. That they would have expected that he would be the one who would reason with the directors of Lonmin and its higher management to say, we need to approach this way in a way that respects workers' rights, in a way that will actually create workplace harmony. And he didn't do that. And unfortunately, the experience, as you point out, even with Ria Pecha, is that after the massacre, she said, this represents the best of responsible policing. We have killed 34 people. 2 days before, we'd killed 3 people. And this represents the best of responsible policing.
As if they were just nothing. The people were nothing, yes.
Exactly. That we just cut down some trees. And unfortunately, no one can explain what went on in their minds. It could be possibly that they only see themselves being accountable to those with big pockets, like mining capital, that they see the value of the lives of the 37 miners as nothing. Unfortunately, there's been a reverberating message from the last 12 years that has been walked by the families of the deceased. And that message has been, your husbands, your partners, your sons, your brothers only count as employees of lawnmen. They don't count as members of families. They don't count as friends. They don't count as people that should be grieved for. Mm. And that's why we won't compensate for those losses. Because for us, what's important is the money that they could send to you. And as I mentioned earlier on, even that has exceptions. If we are able to find a fine print to run away from compensating you from that, we'll take away the food on your table, we'll murder your brother, your uncle in cold blood, and we will not account for it. The reason why the Mpumza family's name keeps coming up is that also the Mpumza is actually the one person whose shooters were also recorded saying, yeah, you thought the Mukti would save you. Mm. Look at you now. So it's not that people don't know who shot Thobile Mpumza. They know exactly. Where are those police today? They are still in the SAPS serving. They've never been disciplined for what happened. They've not been criminally prosecuted for what happened. His case alone could be just sanctioned, just separated, and someone can say, you're going to account for what happened to Thobile Mpumza. He was 26 years old. His parents had died a few years before. He saw his role as keeping his family together, as providing for them. And the state today continuously says, whatever he wanted to do as a young black man from the rural Eastern Cape, it counts for nothing. For us, the only value that his life could have is if there could be a lawnman in play. And even if you're able to show that whatever he earned, he sent home, we don't care because we have a fine print that we can hide under and we'll give you nothing for his life.
Rehad, I've just got 1 minute and I want to get your take on this. At the time in 2012, or just post that, rock drillers within Lonman Mine had earned 5,000 a month. If you calculate it, 60,000 annually. The last financial year, Neil Froneman, who is the chief executive officer of what is now Sibanye Stillwater, took home 300 million plus as a, of course, earnings sitting on the board. If there was ever a bigger disparity of how corporations and its workers in terms of earnings and the bigger gap that is there, this represents it, doesn't it?
On average, earn 100 times more than the workers in these large companies. That never mind the big CEOs have got all these shares and so on, which push up their earnings to astronomically disgusting levels, when in a country where the most unequal in the world. And I think this leads to a contempt for the poor, these high levels of inequality. And we're seeing it, the lack of accountability. You know, we've seen it in the Zuma years where they get into bed with some Indian businessman and rip the country off for hundreds of millions of US dollars. We see it in the provincial government where they're using these budgets as feeding troughs for the political elites, and also in local government. In Johannesburg, where I live, you know, I was in town the other day, you know, despite the fact that the power cuts have stopped, half of the traffic lights aren't working, there's rubbish in the streets, there's homelessness everywhere. We have water shedding now very regularly. Our state is in the process of failing. And if we don't begin to take political accountability and police accountability in the case of Marikana very seriously, we continue to see these high deaths in police custody of civilians. We'll continue to see less and less people voting. We'll continue to see rising levels of anger, and our government and our society will become increasingly stable. And this is what we've got to fight against. We've got to take the power back from the political class and to demand that citizens are empowered, that government is held accountable, that our political class are responsible, are mature, and begin to take the needs and concerns of our residents seriously at all levels of government. Because without it, we are heading spiraling down very fast. So that's the importance for me of Marikana. It's much wider than just the massacre and the justice required, still required for those victims. It's about the what it says about the South African government, the South African state.
After the break, education. What can the current generation, what can the future generation learn about this day, but not just about that day, the role of conglomerates, the role of capitalism, the role of the state, but most importantly, learning about the plight of the very worker on the street. Do stay tuned. We'll be back after this break. Welcome back to Talking Point. Education. What can the current, what can the future generation learn about this deadly massacre that happened on August the 16th, 2012? Rehad, of course, your documentary, Miners Shot Down, is one form of education. But there's so many that can be brought into light. How important is it that the understanding of this massacre gets reverberated through the generations that are going to come to understand the reality of South Africa, to understand the economics of South Africa, but most importantly, the fact that there remains such a big disparity amongst the political elite, the capitalist elite, and that of the very worker on the ground?
Thank you for that question, Fahraaz. Very important. I just want to make one correction. So I said the average general worker in large-scale businesses, compared to a senior manager, earns just over 20 times less. Or put it the other way, a senior manager in a large-scale business earns over 20 times the amount of a general worker. Now, this is why we need to remember Marikana, is because what we're seeing is an elite compacting, really, of the political and the economic elite in this country. And these are for self-serving interests. They are not serving the interests of our wider population, 60% who live on or below the poverty line, earning less than 5,000 rand per month for these many households. This is a devastating fact for those who live on such a wage, because we're seeing higher levels of malnutrition. We're seeing people not being able to finish school or get into university. We're seeing rising levels of unemployment. And we're not going to be able to unless we can really get to the root of our problem here in terms of these rising inequality, rising levels of poverty, and rising levels of unemployment, we're not going to realize the dream of the democracy which people fought so hard and fast for over 70, 80 years from the founding of the African National Congress. It's going to disappear, and with it, the future of millions upon millions of school children, young people. And they've now got to fight for their own future and step into the ring and ask the hard questions about the nature of our society and what their role is in changing it.
Rehad, we'd like to thank you so much for joining us here on Talking Point, sharing, of course, your experiences in making this documentary. Really do appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That's Rehad Desai, of course, the director of the documentary film Miners Shot Down. Nomzamo, similar question to you, but from a more legal perspective. You know, anyone who's going to be studying law could be taking, you know, excerpts of what is happening now, especially criminal law, especially constitutional law. As somebody, as a lawyer yourself, as somebody who's obviously been in the legal fraternity all this time, I mean, what are the lessons the future and the current generation can learn in terms of dealing with this from an emotional perspective, from a law perspective, but most importantly, finding justice for families who have suffered, like what the families have suffered of Marikana?
Look, so I think the one thing that I would share is that it's important for us to see the impact of such incidents on the constitutional rights of victims, and also understand that when you call for justice for the Marikana victims, you are in effect calling for the actualization of the vision of our constitution. And so if I'm speaking to law students or aspiring lawyers, I would say, I hope that in your own practice of the law, you would consider how you can actualize our constitution by supporting those that are on the margins, those that have been wronged by private and public power. And then I would say for those who are wondering, how do they see themselves against the state in these conditions? And I would want them to be inspired by the life of those miners. I always point out that more than half of them were youth, that this strike was started by people who were discussing their workplace conditions in a soccer field. And so they understood that while they were playing soccer, their politics demanded that they talk about their wages and how they can change their living conditions and the conditions back home where they come from. And to say to them, you are a political actor. You can make a decision. You can stand up for your rights, and you can stand up for the rights of other people living in South Africa.
Nomzamo, thank you so much for joining us here on Talking Point on Hilaal TV. Much appreciated.
Thank you.
That's Nomzamo Zondo. She is the executive director for the Socioeconomics Rights Institute, and of course had with me Rehad Desai, the director of the documentary film Miners Shot Down. 12 years on, next year it's going to be 13. We probably will be speaking about this again on Talking Point. But we hope that when we speak about this, we are halfway through potential justice for these victims, and that there are going to be at least some answers to the questions posed by so many people who are victims of this tragic day. From myself, Fahraaz Patel, team here in Johannesburg, thank you so much for joining us. Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.